was a big thing with the foresters. I mean, it wasn't just Fitchburg. It was multiple, I believe, Fall River. I can't remember all the places off the top of my head, but they basically were upset because they wanted them to stop using French at their meetings. They wanted them to go all English. So it was kind of like, we're not happy about this. This is how we've been conducting business. We're not doing this anymore. And we're going to create our own group similar to what we've already been in. And you know, I think they built one of the last article I just found recently, it talked about that Fitchburg was one of the leading cities kind of spearheading that effort. I think it was New Bedford, an article from the New Bedford paper that mentioned something about that.
So leading and
keeping that language, keeping and breaking away, kind of like we were not the first ones, but we were following suit. You know, we're done with that, and it all started with a convention that basically forbade them to have their meetings in French. But there was the second forester group, the City of Fitchburg forester group, and the forester group that was from pretty much French speaking was Court Montcalm. So there was two different groups. And it says in the article that the City of Fitchburg group basically conducted their business in English and the other group conducted their meetings in French.
And it was interesting, so a lot of the businesses were Main Street downtown Fitchburg who were not French, of French ancestry, and their ads were in French.
Yep.
So you can see where they thought their market was.
Yep. It looks like to me, you know, that again, that 40s was kind of the turning point, but then like the 80s, it kind of had that revival kind of, and even in that video I sent, it kind of talks about that they're fixing up the buildings and you see the fair at St. Joe's. And I mean, I remember as a kid going to the fair at St. Joe's a couple of times. They had the parking lot with all the rides. I mean, I don't know if they still do that, but, you know, it just that seemed like there was a real, people were excited about it still and that sort of thing.
Yeah, coming back to the old neighborhood, basically, mm-hmm. where there are a lot of relatives still there.
Yep. No, yeah. Even myself, we as a kid, would go back to Fitchburg, go visit Aunt so-and-so, or, you know, they all still pretty much lived in Fitchburg at that time.
And it was probably also an opportunity for the older people
mm-hmm.
to be able to speak French as a community.
Yep.
Which they probably didn't have, at that period of time, they probably didn't have that much of an opportunity to do that anymore. Mm-hmm. Now is a good venue for them to be able to do that.
Yep.
That's the interesting thing about language. It stretches the way your mind conceives things. And if you have two different languages, I was bilingual.
Yes.
Because I think it awakens opportunities and thoughts that you might not normally think of, because you don't have the experience of the thought pattern of another language.
Yeah, totally agree.
I think that's important.
It is. I mean, I'm sad I didn't learn French. I mean, if I was in, you know, another culture and it was their language, I would be sad if I didn't learn that language either. I mean, it doesn't matter what language it was, but if your family was bilingual, it just kind of stopped at one point, unfortunately. And I feel like I missed out. I mean, I could learn it as an adult, yes, but you know, I'll never know, like, you know, my ancestors, their tone and how they talked, like, I don't, you know, that wasn't passed down to me.
And I think when you do learn a language like that as an adult, I think you lose a lot of the subtleties because you didn't grow up with the language. And I don't think you can recreate that.
I think dialect is the word. You lost that family dialect that they could have passed down to you. And yeah, you can learn it from a book or an audio tape or some other family talking, but you've lost your connection to that language. You have to really be immersed in that culture to really... That's my family. My parents, my dad's from... His family's pretty much from Quebec, and my mom's side's pretty much Acadian. So, you know, I mean, people do marry like that, but yes, they can be somewhat different in their... You know, language and also a little bit on the culture thing. I mean, the Acadians have some things and the Quebec folks.
Yeah, I was reading about that recently. They were really from two different parts of France. And their own cultural history in France was different even.
Mm-hmm.
So you can understand when they came here, we Londoners think of them as being French Canadian, but really, they have their own particular backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure where the people from Quebec were from.
Yeah.
But from what I read, it was from a different part of France.
Okay.
It'd be interesting to find out how that happened, too. I think a lot of it had to do with when France was looking to settle what they called New France at that time. And they were concerned because the English colonies' population was growing so fast, and theirs was not.
Yeah.
And they were concerned, and they were trying to recruit people.
Well, they had the Filles du Roi program, which they basically sent girls that wanted to. They got a small dowry and some, I think, I don't know, clothes or something, but they were basically sent over. They were going to marry someone that they picked, which is interesting that they could pick at that time, that they weren't just matched up with someone. They would basically go to like a convent and you would marry with the intention of you're going to just populate and have a family. And I mean, you go from France, I mean, maybe your, you know, lifestyle wasn't that great. Maybe you were, you know, poverty stricken or such. I mean, at least you had a little beginning, but you were basically going out in the wilds of Quebec at that point. You know, it wasn't just going to down the street to the local store or something like that. So you'd be pretty much building your homestead, or if the husband already had it, and, you know, building a family. And
in some of these people, too, it was a financial necessity.
Mm-hmm.
If they were orphans,
mm-hmm. yeah.
they had no, there's no government to fall back on.
Right.
And they needed a way to take care of themselves. And that was an opportunity.
It was, yep. Yeah. I mean, I know myself, I have some Filles du Roi. Most people that have descendancy from Quebec have a Filles du Roi or multiple Filles du Roi in there, along with some other. Not going to start going down that road, but yes, there's other people that you can be descended from for that. There's the, and I'm probably pronouncing this wrong, you can also have a descendant of the soldier de Carignan, I forget exactly what that is, or a Fille de Meyer, which I think they were before or after the Fille de Oise. So there's a couple different things you can descend from, and, you know, there's lineage societies for those, and you can, if you can prove your lineage back to them, you can join something like that, or if you want to do research on that, you know, you can find, there's lists and websites that have lists of these people that you can try to trace yourself back to. Well, most people say your name's not French, it actually is. It used to be Bennett before my two times great-grandfather came to the States, then it somehow flipped to Bennett.
Now see, now this is interesting. Because I had read that Daniels, probably that he donated to Cleghorn, to Andrew Cleghorn, to build the mill on.
Yes.
He donated that property.
Yep.
And that part of the property was land that Daniels himself had previously owned from through an inheritance. That's where it appeared. And part of that property he had bought from Andrew Pratt.
And
he built that in 1885. Here, 1884, the year before, in September, Pratt sold some land to John Daniels. I bet that's the property that the mill ended up on.
Yeah,
it's amazing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it says cloudy weather of Labor Day. When was this? March? Oh, wait, that doesn't say Labor. I don't know what that says. Or maybe it does say. Did not dampen the enthusiasm for the people of this district. Afternoon saw nearly 2,000 people assembled. Witness the sports which had been provided, and the committee in charge, large number of entries, and then they talk about the wood sawing contest for men, the cake eating contest,
so
the spoon race, I don't know what that is, the 100 yards dash for boys, fat men's race, fat women's race, I don't know what that is.
Apparently, and this is fairly early on in the history of Cleghorn,
mm-hmm.
because the community had only been in existence for, at this point, maybe 15, 20 years. A group of citizens felt there was a need for improvement in the, what they thought was improvement in the landscape. In other words, it's a community project to improve the appearance and the livability
yep.
of the
yep.
neighborhood.
Yeah.
That's what they were interested in.
Mm-hmm. And the name of it, again, was?
It was the Cleghorn Landscape Improvement Society.
Thank you, because I couldn't remember the whole thing.
Yeah, and it was interesting, and this did happen fairly early on, because the meeting with that organization was formed, and the first group of officers were elected.
Yep.
That meeting was held at St. Joe's School, in the school building. They probably had an auditorium of some sort. And they, also at that meeting, there was an award ceremony for a garden competition in Cleghorn. And the people who donated the money to that were John Daniels and Patrick, I'm sorry, and Andrew Pratt. And you see those people being back in distant history, they weren't really. And I'm sure there's a monetary reward part of that for him. But there's also a civic interest. For example, being involved in this garden competition, that's what he brought in the prize money. I mean, he was interested in Cleghorn for more than just a monetary profit.
Well, it also gets the community involved, not just because of the purpose of the organization, but it's another social way for people to interact and and keep the community nice, and you know, everybody wants to involve themselves too. Maybe not to the level of what he had, but it's making people involved and caring about what's going on.
And I think part of it is because people are raising their own food.
Yeah.
And so it's like you found all those awards for different foods.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, obviously, this must be what some people are, quite a few people were growing. Again, this is from the Fitchburg Sentinel in September 3rd, 1912. So onions, there was a first prize for onions, turnips. This is salads. I guess maybe they made their own salads to show off. Cucumbers, celery, squash, apples, crab apples. So some of the...
Yeah, well, and it's interesting about the apples, because there was a good-sized orchard one time in Cleghorn. I mean, that's where the name Orchard Street came from. That was the orchard.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Also, two of the nuns were involved here. They it looks like they won first place for I don't know what that says here. Looks like I'm not sure exactly what that says, but they won first place for something, so they were involved, and they also won second place for pears. Gooseberries.
A sense of its own identity. It didn't take that long.
No, it grew fast.
Within about 10 years, that area had, that district had a sense of its own identity. And particularly back when the main mode of transportation was walking, and they had all their own little shops and businesses, and it was pretty self-supporting in a lot of ways.
I think you had found something the last time. Was it like 50 or 100 like businesses? I can't remember
over 100,
exactly.
At one point, it was over 100 businesses.
Or maybe it was you that told me that.
Yeah.
I can't recall.
Yeah, over 100 businesses in Cleghorn.
Yeah, isn't that incredible?
Yeah, that's amazing.
And people I know that have told me about different locations of the businesses, sometimes they're, you know, they're not listed in our directories because they're sort of subletting from another business.
That's
they're
sore.
A little bit in the back,
yeah.
They're upstairs, in the basement.
Yeah. I know of a couple of bakeries that were in Cleghorn that were that way.
Mm-hmm.
And they ran the business out of their home, and I don't think it was ever listed in the city directory, except for one way. When you look down the street to a person's name, it say that they were a baker.
Mm-hmm.
And when told where they were employed, it was the same address as the house they were living at.
Ah.
That's the only indication that you had that person had a bakery in their own home.
Gotcha.
I don't know a lot about it, but what I have read about it was when he came down from Quebec.
Yes, that I know.
He had $300 because he sold the family farm. He had $300. And he bought a part interest in a hardware store, I think, on Fairmont Street in Claremont. And that's how we got started.
Wow.
One thing I was struck about was how often people seem to move. But they moved within Claremont.
Mm-hmm.
I've been following a number of people going through the directories. And one year they're living on one street, maybe on Fairmont Street. The next year they were on Clarendon. The next year they were on Chester. But when you look at on a map, they're only like 3 or 4 blocks away from all of these locations.
I wonder though, is it the same size place that they moved to a larger place, a smaller place? Like, did they have another kid or two? Or I mean, it'd be interesting to know those.
I don't know, but it's amazing how often people moved and how often people changed jobs. Sometimes I'd follow one person and they'd work 2 or 3 years in one mill, then they'd be another year to another mill, another year they'd be someplace else, 2 or 3 years they'd be someplace else. I was just really kind of surprised. And some of that might have been the factories, maybe they laid off people if they ran out of contracts or something. I mean, I don't know. I'm just speculating. It's not what you typically see today.
Yeah.
I mean, for my own family, I don't really can say that I've seen that other than one person, like following people doing the genealogy part of it. But again, that's my own family.
Yeah. 1 year someone was living on Cleghorn Street, mm-hmm. The next year they were living on Fairmont, the next year they were living on Clarendon.
They could have went back up for 6 months.
They went to Canada, came back, and that's why they were working in another factory.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it could have been what was
happening.
Especially if they were young people, because I've even heard people tell this story from their family stories, that part of what you were doing up there is you've got all these connections, mm-hmm. is you're meeting people of your own age, mm-hmm. and seeing if you fall in love with somebody.
We've all had our immigration story. I mean, ours is past, meeting French Canadians coming to Fitchburg, and now it's a new time and a new group of, well, they're not really immigrants per se much more right now, but I mean, it's the next group that's filling that spot, and you know, they're making it, they're putting their touch on it.
They were making fuses for military munitions.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's what they were doing. After the war period, of course, that market went away, and they were going back into locks. And I think the problem that they were having was, after the war, they found that they could not compete with other companies that had lower manufacturing costs.
Oh, right.
And that's when they started looking to relocate. And they finally did. I'm not sure how that structure came about, whether it was a merger or whether they were bought. But they ended up joining up with another company and relocating down south. Yeah, that had to have had a devastating impact on the community. It had to.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's interesting. In the complex that had been the Cleghorn Mill, there's a big marijuana growing facility in there now. But it's interesting to see how those buildings are being redeveloped. There's a lot of tremendous space in town. It's interesting to see how they're redeveloping it too for apartments, condos.
Yeah.
It's going to be interesting to see how that, speaking about that, how that development on Warren Square goes. I mean, they're like a block from the train station.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think the upper stories are going to be residential.
Yeah.
That sort of thing changed the whole complexion of town, because all those people are going to be wanting amenities, they're going to want restaurants,
mm-hmm.
stores.
Yep.
And that's a great little segue, because I mean, it sort of brings it full circle that we saw that in the 1880s that they built, how you know, that Cleghorn got built up because housing was desperately needed.
Yep.
Yeah, and same thing, all those 100 businesses, mm-hmm. in Cleghorn, and those all formed within a couple of decades.
Yep.
And it was all from people.